I'm Adam Wilborn.
And I'm Andy Murray.
And this is the news.
We're going to start off by talking about what might be a card leak for Full Gear 2021. That's the next AEW pay-per-view taking place in Minneapolis, Minnesota on the 13th of November.
Which is a Saturday, thank Christ.
I know, very charitable to the UK viewers, that one. Tony Khan was pictured at a Jacksonville Jaguars, I believe that's Jaguars.
They were playing the Tennessee Titans. Yes, hey, go on, bro.
Baltimore Bastards, sadly, not involved in that one. They didn't even interfere in the finish. What the hell? But he was photographed at this game over the weekend. Notebook clutched to his chest. On it were listed a bunch of different matches. When you zoom in, the picture becomes a little bit clearer. I say a little bit because Tony Khan, much like me, has like not great handwriting, to be fair. But here's what you can make out if you really look at it.
Have you been doing the old zooming enhance gimmick?
I've been zooming and looming with a broom.
Right, I don't know this. I genuinely haven't looked at this story or this card yet, so I'm going to react in person now.
Right, well, this one's the most surprising of all. Kenny Omega versus Hangman Page.
Oh, my goodness.
What a shocker. Jon Moxley versus Bryan Danielson.
I'm leaning on WWE a little bit too much there, but okay.
There you go. The Inner Circle versus American Top Team.
Yeah. Oh, what?
Yeah, they're just booking these ex-UFC guys now.
Good luck, John Silver.
Coasting on another company.
Oh, no, the Inner Circle, sorry. I'm thinking the Dark Order, but yes, even so.
There you go. That's the Twitter stuff. MJF versus Darby Allin.
Yeah, good.
CM Punk versus Wardlow. Interesting.
Well, it'd be nice knowing you, CM Punk.
Yeah, enjoy that knee off the top. Joking, of course, we love Wardlow. Thunder Rosa versus Jade Cargill.
Nice.
Christian Cage versus Adam Cole.
Oh.
And the Young Bucks versus Jurassic Express.
Well, you can't have everything.
Now also listed on this are a match for Britt Baker, but no opponent next to her, and Cody Rhodes versus either Malakai Black, Andrade El Idolo, or Miro. So, lots of stuff going on here. Hangman versus the world champion man, Kenny Omega.
Yeah.
That is official. Tony confirmed that earlier in the week. So that one's set in stone. The rest of these are up in the air. I think there's a very good chance that he's done this on purpose to throw people off the scent. What do you reckon?
I agree. Tony Khan is well known as a bit of a scamp.
He's a rascal, isn't he?
And wandering around a professional football game where there are, I don't think I'm being hyperbolic here, millions of cameras with the literal card for your next pay-per-view on the front of it and no one going, what you got there, Tone?
Hey guys, do you just want to take a photo?
I'm not buying it. I think a lot of them may well be close to reality, but I'm not sure if it's exactly verbatim what it is. I don't want to see Cody Rhodes facing any more heels, brother. He's a heel. So just to react to that one. I think it may well be quite close to what we're going to get. I think Moxley Danielson is a very out-of-nowhere suggestion.
Maybe but tournament final?
As is Punk Wardlow. Yeah, I didn't even think of that. Yeah, Punk Wardlow as well. Intriguing. Look, MJF Darby Allin is where we're heading for Full Gear. But so I think it's close to what we may well get, and maybe this is him, you know, like our government does, sort of sending out feelers in the media to see how people react to stuff, and then going, oh, well, seeing as everyone likes it, we'll do that then.
99% of the time, they're bad things.
Yeah.
Being in the UK.
But this is the opposite of that. Yeah. But I don't know. I think you're right. I don't foresee him just one page. He's got the Full Gear card, and the rest is ideas for plays for Jacksonville Jaguars. Nah.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see how it pans out, of course. But if it is a work, it's an interesting and novel one.
Yes.
So there we go.
Sticking with AEW though, they could be bringing you their own version of the WWE Network soon. They're apparently in discussions with media partner Warner Media over a deal to make the promotion's entire content library available to fans. This is according to Tony Khan. He's interviewed by Brandon Walker of Barstool Sports earlier this week. We reported on this yesterday. Day, of course, and he said that he wants a solution for fans to be able to watch old episodes of Dynamite, Rampage, Dark, and Dark Elevation, as well as, of course, as the pay-per-views and the House Always Wins live event that went down on the 9th of April, which is apparently, well, which as we know, has never aired. Yeah. Look, we were talking about this in the office. They have got a fairly decent back catalogue to launch this sort of thing. It's obviously not going to compare to the vast WWE Network. But, I mean the boys in the office have been speculating this is going to be happening for quite some time anyway.
Yeah, we've spoken about this on videos for the past 2 years, really, since AEW existed, how in order to make something like this viable, say it is a monthly premium subscription fee, if you're paying $9.99 a month, you can't do that if you only have 2 pay-per-views and 10 TV shows, right? You need years of content and everything else. Nothing is ever going to be as good value as the WWE Network, where they've got all... It's like a historical library of pro wrestling. I love the net. I would never cancel it in a million years. I mean, the bosses hook us up here. But if I ever... didn't work in wrestling media, I'd pay for it forever because it's so good. AEW will have their stuff on there. They've got a couple of years now. They've got, what, like 12, 15 pay-per-views?
Potentially, I know it's on YouTube, you get to potentially Hoy being the Elite on there as well.
Yeah, you can throw that on there. You can make documentaries. You can do whatever the hell you want.
Oh, the Road Twos, yeah.
Countdowns, Road Twos, all kinds of cool stuff you can do. We're at the point now where it makes sense, and I'm not surprised by this.
I literally did a list written by one Michael Hamflett about wrestling headlines from 2025, sort of predicting things to come. As you know, I've never predicted anything wrong.
Never been wrong.
And yeah, on there was an AEW Network, so looks like we got the first one correct in 2021. Good work, Hamflett.
There you go, 4 years ahead of time. Gee whiz, what a boy. Let's move over to another story here, and this is reported by Voices of Wrestling last night.
This is tasty, this one.
Yeah, this is going to get people annoyed. Scoop coming through last night from those fellas. Following up on a tip they'd received and then confirming it with a couple of, or at least one of the outlets in question, WWE's been leaking AEW Rampage's overnight numbers, their Fast National numbers. Now, those are the numbers that come out over the weekend. They're not typically made publicly available. However, they've been appearing with increasing... Increasingly,
that's the word
I was looking for. My dictionary is malfunctioning today, but they've been coming apart more and more recently. AEW's numbers, SmackDown obviously comes out on a Friday night, right? And SmackDown going out as it does on Fox always is going to eclipse this show. 2 million, whatever. But that's the Voices of Wrestling report there. Now, you want to speculate on the reasons? You want to throw some theories out there behind this? I've got a few, and they're kind of in line with the guys here. I think that when you look at that number, when, like, last week it was like the Fast National was in the 400,000.
Yeah, start with a 4, definitely.
If you put that out there, right, and then your show comes out there and looks like 2 million, who looks good? Who looks good coming out of that thing? This is purely speculative. We're just kind of spitballing on this situation as well. But it would spark a conversation when that thing goes out there. And if you look at the quality of the conversation on the Rampage ratings, it's not good. It's not good. Every single week. Last week, I think, was the first Rampage number that you could look at and say that is objectively bad. Because it finished 15th on the night on cable, where every show prior to that had finished in the top 5. A lot of people look at these numbers and go, hey, they've fallen. Hey, it's 500. Hey, it's 600. Whatever. Well, cool. It's on at 10 p.m. on a Friday night when everyone else is out drinking, having fun, doing whatever. The Rampage numbers thus far have been exceptional for the time slot. Last week wasn't good. MLB competition, it crucified NXT last week as well, and killed Raw this week too. This week, we'll see what happens. We predicted not good things for Rampage this week, but that's
good idea. Yeah, not a good idea to try and call out SmackDown, Tony Khan.
Yeah, and if you follow the path, however, you can kind of figure out why WWE might want to leak this. But coming from Voices of Wrestling there, what do you reckon?
I think this is brilliant.
It's fun.
Like this.
Yeah.
Like I said, I haven't picked a side in this war. I'm just sitting back and watching the flames go back and forth between the two groups.
Stuff rules.
And particularly the fans of two groups, because guess what? I'm not sure if people know this. You can enjoy both. I still really like, for my sins, a lot of WWE stuff. I enjoy watching SmackDown. I thought Raw, aside from this week, has actually been quite good recently. And Dynamite has been sensational, of course, for quite a while now. And Rampage, it's a bit iffy. You know, I'm an AEW fan.
Great show.
But you sit there in the office and you say, it's not great, to be honest, pal.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot that they can do to improve it. But, the sneakiness of going, we do know that AEW did 400,000 this week. It's a bit iffy, because it's a bit like, I suppose, going to a football game, guessing the attendance, but always sort of lowballing it, and then officially the stuff comes out on Monday.
It comes out on Monday, it's a bit higher, It's just like, it seems to me like an attempt at stoking bad conversations, which happen every single week.
Indeed. Right, let's conclude by talking about that NXT 2.0 star that WWE are up for. Surprisingly, it's not Tony D'Angelo yet. Although he will be world champion within the year, I reckon, because I love that man. And he's probably just going to Whack, the world champion. It's Carmelo Hayes, your new NXT North American champion. He, of course, cashed in that thing he got for winning the NXT Breakout Tournament. He automatically gives him a title shot. He did it after Isaiah Swerve Scott defended the North American Championship against one of, Santos Escobar. On Tuesday night, even. He cashed that in. He's now NXT North American champion. And apparently WWE, and specifically Shawn Michaels, are a big, big fan of his. They have been for a while. This is according to Fightful Select. No crap, just Sap, Sean Ross Sap of Fightful Select. He had his NXT debut against Kushida. He faced Adam Cole on the 22nd of June. They've been wanting to give him loads of opportunities. They obviously turned him heel, palling him up with Trick Williams. Now he's NXT North American champion. Shawn Michaels reportedly sees a lot of himself in Carmelo Hayes, and I think Carmelo's a fantastically talented star. I'm glad he's got a title, and he's got the push and the support of the right people backstage too.
Yeah, I like him a lot as well. I've liked him since he came in as a babyface, and I like him with Trick Williams now. The angle this week was fun. It was a cool way to close the show, send Swerve off to the main roster and give Carmelo the rub. I think he's one of the best things on the show every single week. Can't give the guy enough praise, really. I think if there's any justice in the world, this guy will go on to become a major star.
Before we move on, there was the photo of him with the new title alongside Shawn Michaels. Any advice you want to give Shawn Michaels?
Shave it off, mate. The time has come. Like, you've been clinging on to this thing atop your head for far too long, my brother. Just from one bald to another. I know I'm half your age, but shave it off.
Yeah.
You'll feel good.
Right, let's move on to your Twitter questions. At What Culture WWE, of course, we want to get in touch with this first question today. It comes from Mark Smith, who says, morning, legends. Who do you think should get the rub of ending CM Punk's unbeaten return to wrestling? Me, I'd go for Jungle Boy on his long rise to the top to beat MJF for the title.
Very interesting. I think I'm going to go with Ricky Starks. I love the idea of Ricky Starks and CM Punk being drawn together in the first round of the upcoming title tournament, the Eliminator tournament. And Ricky beating him in the first round. I think that'll be a pretty interesting turn to take. You've got a bit of history between them now, of course, from the Team Taz feud and the Powerhouse Hobbs match. Be a cool way to give Ricky a nice rub and do a new wrinkle for this Punk storyline as he adjusts to being the old guy on the roster.
You can probably guess who my pick's going to be.
Billy Kay.
No, it's MJF, of course. And I'd have MJF defeat him as CM Punk challenges for the world title. We've had a little pasty bet in the office. MJF is my pick to win that AEW title eliminator tournament. He faces Hangman Page and loses. Hangman Page loses the title on his first defense. Sorry, Hangman Page, you'll get more title reigns if I'm booking. Don't worry. And then you build up CM Punk, gets all the right wins to go up, doesn't lose. Undefeated, CM Punk goes up against MJF at the next pay-per-view, whatever that is. Revolution, quite possibly. Yes. I'm going to go with that.
Yep.
And it's like, oh my God, here we go. CM Punk's going to be AEW World Champion. Nope. MJF beats him. Can you imagine how unbearable he would be? I mean, the build-up to it would be sensational. Me and Sid were talking about this on a podcast yesterday, and Sid suggested MJF said the line, can you really have the gall to say you can be the world champion because of the UFC stuff,
basically.
And I suggested he's made some awkward comments about the relationship backstage between CM Punk and Colt Cabana. Ooh, you rushed through backstage a little bit too quickly there, brother. Like, I think it's perfect, but yeah, Jungle Boy as well. Like, this is the intrigue and the excitement around AEW, because who's going to beat Bryan Danielson first? Who's going to win this Eliminator tournament? Blah, blah, blah. It's such an exciting time. Anyway, sticking with AEW, Jake says, as a way to combat crowd fatigue, how would you feel if AEW taped Dark and Dark Elevation much earlier in the day before crowds arrive at the venue and when the ring's surrounded by AEW talent instead? Now, they don't shoot Dark anymore, do they, at TV?
They shoot it at Universal Studios in Orlando, Florida. So, yeah, it's a little bit different. It's an interesting question. Maybe there is something in, I mean, you watch Rampage, right? And after they usually put the popping match on first, and then after that, it's like the crowd starts to get tired, which is very natural. It's a valid idea. I wonder how many people, however, would be willing to structure their entire day around Elevation going on and then coming back to the arena and doing this. And even if you put wrestlers around the ring, it's structurally, it's a very difficult challenge. I think they're probably best just going the way they've been going just now.
Yeah, exactly. But there is certainly an issue, and we don't really have the answer to how to fix that with tape and Rampage afterwards. crowd fatigue, but it'll be interesting to see how they deal with it because it's something they do have to tackle ASAP. Right, final question today comes from Angela Dawn, who says, in your own opinion, what do you think is the greatest women's match of all time so far? Angela picks Sasha Banks versus Bayley from TakeOver Brooklyn 2015. She's also got an H for you. Do you want me to save that for the bit at the end?
Do it now, baby.
She says, I also have an H for Andy, Humdinger, which means a remarkable personal thing.
Yeah, that describes both of us quite well.
Thank you very much,
Angela. And the crazy frog. That's a remarkable thing.
Greatest women's match of all time?
What a broad question. I think Bayley and Sasha is a great answer, mm-hmm. and it's certainly in the conversation. For me, I always go back to the most acclaimed of the Aja Kong versus Minami Toyota matches from, I think it's August, it's 1997. It goes 30 minutes. It's a non-stop whirlwind of violence. It's absolutely incredible. Check out. You can find it on the internet, on the YouTube.
It is worth checking out.
It's brutal.
I can't believe Stephanie McMahon brought us the Women's Revolution with that. Incredible. How old is she then? That happened? Like 20 or something?
It's 15.
Amazing booking. My pick is the correct pick. It's the Women's Tag Team Title Match from WrestleMania 35. Name me a better moment in women's wrestling. You can't. Right, let's move on to today's and finally. Huge popper I saw this morning on Twitter, Andy. Came out last night from Hangman Page, who simply tweeted, hey, I'm at the building. There's no one here. Do you want me for Dynamite tonight or what? Because I'll go back home. Fantastic. I loved having a line this morning, having to not watch AEW Dynamite because it's on Saturday, of course.
Yeah. It's like it's the easiest show to wake up to because it moves so fast, right? But at the same time, when you have a straight choice between getting up an hour earlier or not getting up an hour earlier and you've had a busy week, I know what I'm thinking.
I finally got around to watching a bit of Squid Game instead last night.
Squid Game.
Green light. Red light.
I'm ready to go.
No, that's not the different two different things. Anyway, let us know your thoughts on that. Actually, part watch you there. Don't forget we're doing the thing with Top Rope Brewing and Survivor Series, or as we're calling it, Survivor Beeries. 12 pack of craft beers, delicious beer, £45, free delivery using the code Here's Why. Unfortunately, only available for our UK fans. We will be doing something in the US very soon. But if you want to get your hands on those 12 delicious craft beers, I said it like that. In the comments section or in the description, there will be a link to all that. As I said, use code Here's Why for free delivery here in the UK. Plus, let us know your thoughts on everything we've discussed in the comments section. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And subscribe to What Culture Wrestling, wherever you get your podcast from, for daily wrestling podcast. Plus, you can let us know your thoughts and Twitter questions on Twitter at WhatCultureWWE. Why don't you hit follow both of us? You can follow Andy Murray at...
Follow me at Andy H. Murray. The H stands for, hey, leave them kids alone.
You can follow me at Adam Wilbur. Follow us all at WhatCultureWWE. But for now, my thanks to Andy Murray. Thank you for joining us. And we will see you soon.